Hello, my name is Terry Dean, and I'd like to welcome you to another edition of Solon Speaks. Our featured guest today is Don Holub, who is the Director of Recreation for the City of Solon. Don?
Terry, good to see you again.
Always a pleasure to do the Director of Recreation, because we get to talk about fun things. First of all, I do want to thank you that we're doing this indoors. The last time we did this was in July out by the pool. And since we've just had one of the coldest winters on record, this is a lot more fun doing this one inside.
Absolutely. So. We have a little bit of artificial heat for you. How's that?
That's great. Let me tell you, that's a nice feature, considering I think right now it's 20 degrees outside.
Absolutely.
So how you doing?
Terrific. Family's doing well. I have a scary time in the Holub household. My daughter is a senior in high school. And excited about her graduating, but the college, I think, has us all a little bit nervous, so hopefully we'll be ready.
Has she got any colleges in mind yet?
She's looking possibly at Ohio Northern, which is exciting.
Good.
It's a fine school.
Sounds very good. Is she interested in pharmacy? They're known for law and pharmacy, if I remember correctly.
She has a roommate picked out, and her roommate's going into pharmacy, but she's not quite sure yet.
Good. Those decisions can all be made,
absolutely.
That's for sure. So let's talk a little bit about the recreation program, a little bit about Grantwood. We're just ending the what I would call the fall winter season.
Correct.
Did we have lots of people participate in the programs? What programs did they participate in?
Our biggest program that we have, the largest one. One is an adult program. Is our volleyball program, indoor volleyball. Mm-hmm. We had about 12 teams this year. It went very, very well. That one has ended as we speak, and we're going to be looking forward to a spring volleyball program indoor again. And then we move into the outdoors for the summer for mm-hmm. volleyball, sand volleyball that we have. The other program that we have is basketball. Runs through all the age groups, anywhere from kindergarten all the way through eighth grade. And it was very successful this year. We're just ending up. We have about a week and a half left there. And most of the teams are in their playoffs now. So very exciting time. All the people are getting psyched up for the playoffs and ready to go. March Madness, if you will.
Do they have a March Madness as part of the rec program?
We don't, but I guess maybe that's what we'll have to coin it.
That sounds good. Most of the stuff obviously has been the indoor things.
Correct.
And we should probably talk a little bit about what's going to happen now for spring and summer. One great thing I've always loved about the recreation program and the recreation department, certainly your fabulous employees, that's for sure.
Thank you.
The fact that you have so many different programs and that you can accommodate people from, I'm going to say, 1 year old up to 95 year old. Now, I'm not sure that's exactly the right number, but you can accommodate pretty much everybody. Like you just talked about the volleyball, an adult volleyball program. I bet
correct.
That was a lot of fun. So now we're getting into the spring and the summer. So my thinking is baseball and some of those kind of things. What's going to happen for the spring and summer now?
Well, first we start with soccer. We start with an outdoor soccer program that begins in April and May. We try to get that completed. You don't want to have the kids in too many sports at the same time. And both soccer and baseball are probably our most popular sports. So we try to keep those separate as much as possible. We do have a spring program and a fall program in soccer, which is nice. Mm-hmm. But they play outdoors, and that's coming up pretty quickly if the weather ever turns.
If it ever warms up a little bit, right?
Exactly.
Now, are you going to do the summer camps and some of those programs again?
Absolutely. Those are some of the most popular programs that we have. We have what we call our normal summer day camp, which is runs from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock every day during the summer. It's an 8-week program that's run by Tracy Sullivan. She does an excellent job. She's been doing that about 15 years now and is an excellent director, is very well organized, field trips, swimming pool. They do just about anything and everything you can do. Mm-hmm. In the summertime, and kids come back, whether they actually need that as a program or not, as far as a daycare type thing, a lot of kids just come because they love it. Mm-hmm. A lot of socialization in that program. But we also have what we call the summer sports camps, which are very interesting in that we run most of our sports camps through the high school. We work hand in hand with the high school coaches, and it's been very successful for both us, for both the recreation department and for the high school coaches. It's a couple different benefits. The kids benefit by getting to meet the high school coach. It makes it a little bit more interesting for them. See if they, number one, if they like the coach and if they'd like to continue in that program. And the second part of that is the vice versa, if you will. The coach gets to know the kids too. Mm-hmm. And a lot of what happens with the coach is they'll take the proceeds and that'll go back into their program, the money that they make on that program. So it's a win-win-win situation for us. And it's worked out very, very well.
Sounds good. We just finished the Winter Olympics. Any future Olympians you're thinking there, maybe? You know, of course, we're talking summer, not necessarily
Winter
Olympics.
We can always hope. We can always hope.
That would be a nice thing, because everybody starts someplace, that's for sure. So what age groups do the people that go, what age groups attend the summer camps?
The actual day camp that we have is kindergarten through fourth, fifth grade.
Okay.
We used to run a seventh and eighth grade camp, as a matter of fact, and it just, we didn't get the numbers. By seventh or eighth grade, the kids are kind of on their own, want to do their own thing. So, but that program is very successful. Again, we will have anywhere from 350 to 400 participants in each session. So that's a wonderful program for the kids. Now, the sports camps, depends on where the difficulty of the sport. Some of the sports actually try to, they'll break it up into two different sections. They'll do them at different times. All depends on where the coach wants to go with it. Most of the time, those kids are probably third grade and up.
Okay, that sounds good. Now, if you want to register for any of these programs, as I said, these are spring-summer programs. Mm-hmm. When would you start registering? March, April timeframe?
Most of our programs, as of January 1st, you can register for. Okay. The one exception to that would be our day camp. She does have one specific week where she runs that, and she needs her numbers because we have to hire counselors for that. There's a lot involved there. So we try to keep it to a certain point, and we don't take many late registrations on that program either. Most of the other programs, if you're late on registration, that's okay. Baseball, softball. As long as we haven't started games or you know, all the teams are full, we should be okay with late registration.
Right. Now, can you register online? Should you call a phone number? How do you register?
Actually, if you want information, you can call our number, which is 440-248-5747. That's the main line. Most of our programs, you do have to register on site.
Okay, sounds good.
Again, that's why we try to make it as convenient as possible, and we have many out. We have weekend hours. We're open until 7:30, 8:30 at night that you can register. We try to keep it open as much as possible.
Right. And you can come here to the community center
and
register?
Absolutely.
All right, sounds good. What are some of the other activities you're planning for the summer? For example, home days has become one of those things that's now traditional in Solon. It's always one of those nice programs. Are we going to have fireworks for July 4th? Some of those kind of things.
Sure. Let's start with July 4th. July 4th, we will have fireworks. And we actually had two sets of fireworks in the past. We did fireworks on July 4th. We also did fireworks on home days. We're going to switch it up a little bit this year. We're going to spend a little bit more money on the 4th of July fireworks, and we will not have fireworks at home days.
Okay.
We're going to end up on end home days a little earlier on Sunday. So that means if you want to see fireworks this year, you have to come up and see them on July 4th, which is a Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to try to do the Solon Philharmonic Orchestra from the Solon Center for the Arts is going to perform for us. We're going to have some food trucks back that we had last year and some other different food items available for people. So we're going to try to make it a little bit more festive. It's a Friday night again, so it's a good night to do this. And
It sounds like a little bit of the old-fashioned community park picnic.
Correct.
A little more community-oriented.
And we did spend a little bit more on the fireworks, so it should be a little bit better show.
All right, sounds good. Well, the fireworks in the past have really been good, so I can hardly wait
to
see this one.
And people come from all around to see it, so it's pretty nice.
Good. Let's talk a little bit about home days. Now, home days traditionally over the last many years has been a four-day event.
Correct.
I understand that this year it's going to be a three-day event.
Mm-hmm.
Why the change?
Well, you know what? We listened to the people that both attended home days and the people that actually help us run home days and our exhibitors. First of all, the people that the exhibitors felt that 4 days was getting to be a little bit tiring for them. It's a long, long weekend. Most of our city services actually helped participate also, had booths there. And actually, the mayor kind of noticed it last year that people seemed to be a little bit more tired, if you will, on Sunday than in the past. So what we try to do is we're going to try to condense it a little bit, make it a three-day event, still have many, if not all, of the events that we've had in the past, and try to improve on it and make it better, but a three-day event instead of 4 days.
And I understand now that the parade will be changed from Sunday to Saturday.
Correct. And that's really a direct result of the high school band. We feel that the high school band is very important. They get a lot of people out there to see the parade, just to see the band. You know, people wait all summer long to get, you know, they're waiting for the high school football season because they want to see the marching band. I think it's one of the joys that we have here in Solon, one of those things that everybody looks forward to. And if we had it on Sunday, we would be missing the band, so we felt that it was important enough that we were going to move it to Saturday. So we wanted the Solon High School band there, and we moved it to Saturday, and looking forward to it.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, because it wouldn't be Home Days Parade without the Solon High School band.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's half the fun of putting the band together, as you said, in the parade, and kind of, you're right, a few weeks after that, we start football season.
And the band really has a following, really has a great following. People love to hear them. You do get a lot of people that go to the football game on Friday night just to see the band.
Just to hear and see the
Absolutely.
Band. You're right, they're very good. Mm-hmm. It's fun to watch them. Let's talk a little bit about the community center now. I believe the building's 10 to, I think it's 12 years old, isn't it?
11 years old.
11 years old, okay. Certainly people are using it, that's for sure. About how many people use the community center on average per day?
We average about 1,000 citizens a day.
That many?
At least in the recreation side of the community center.
Okay.
That doesn't even count the senior side that we're on right now. And you know, they probably average in the 250 to 350 people in here per day.
Mm-hmm.
So we get quite a few people that use the center.
Okay. From what time of the day is the community center open to what time of the day, approximately?
During the weekdays, it's open from 5:30 a.m. until 9:30 at night. Mm-hmm. And then it's Saturday and Sundays, both, it's open from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m.
Right. So it's pretty accessible to the people of the community.
Absolutely.
And it is open up to the people of Solon. Do we open it up to anybody who lives outside of Solon?
Yes, it's open to two different categories, if you will. We do open it up to Glen Willow residents, because we felt that this goes way back to the opening of the center, that because they were in the same school district, that we were going to open it up to them. They do pay a higher rate, however, than a Solon resident would. And the other person would be if you live or work in Solon, is the working in Solon memberships,
so they
which are also at a higher rate.
All right, so more people can use it that way.
Absolutely.
All right, as I said earlier, when we did this taping or digitalizing or whatever it is we do these days, we did it out by the community pool, which was very nice. The building, as you said, is 11 years old. Are we doing anything to update it to keep the building current? I know you keep the programs current.
Mm-hmm.
Is anything done like to... Is the gym bigger? Do we have more basketball games? Did we fix the pool?
Mm-hmm. We actually have a couple things planned for this summer, and actually the indoor pool would be one of the main portions of that. The indoor pool, because of the atmosphere in there, you have a lot of chlorine, a lot of caustic air, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the wear and tear on the indoor pool is greater than any other place in the building. So after 11 years, that is the area that we feel needs the most in order to improve it.
Mm-hmm.
We plan on closing it at some time this summer. The reason we would do it in the summer is because we still have both outdoor pools, and we may even use the high school indoor pool for some of our programming.
Mm-hmm.
Just to make sure that we are still able to be there for our residents.
So. Are we keeping and operating the Arthur Road pool?
Yes, we do. As a matter of fact, there are a few upgrades going to happen there, including paving the parking lot this year. There's a couple of the outside walls that have been crumbling over the past 5 or 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
An interesting story is that when we built the community center, our hope was that we were going to keep the Arthur Road pool open for about 5 or 6 years at that point in time. And as you just said, we've been open 11 years, and the Arthur Road pool is still going strong.
Mm-hmm.
We have a strong, actually it's gotten stronger as we've gone through the 11 years than it even was when we opened this pool.
Really?
Yeah, the Arthur Road pool has become very popular to a certain set of persons.
To a certain age group, huh?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a nice, you know, it's a nice change of pace for us. And the more residents, obviously, that we can satisfy, the pool's still in very good shape.
Oh.
Believe it or not, that shell is about maybe one or two that are left in America. It's an aluminum pool of that size. It's one of the few Olympic-sized pools left in the area, especially in the area, almost in the whole United States. Most of the other pools are 25 yards or 25 meters. This is still a 50-meter pool. So
it's an Olympic-class pool.
Absolutely.
Interesting. Well, hopefully we'll get some Olympians out of that one, too.
That would be nice.
The Solon Recreation Department probably has to employ people during the summer for these various programs. Do they employ more teenagers, or you know, who do you employ to cover some of these programs? Certainly, things like the sports camps and the children's camps and so forth.
The community center, actually, or the recreation department, if you will, we probably have about 120 to 150 employees throughout the year.
Mm-hmm.
Now, out of that, there's only about 10 of us that are full time,
mm-hmm.
but we still have with part-time personnel, we're at about 130 to 150, I would say. Mm-hmm. In the summertime, we approach 500 employees.
Wow.
And most of those are your kids, your high school and college age students, whether they're doing lifeguarding, working out on the grounds outside, or if they're with the summer camps, the different camps that we run, tennis programs, different things like that.
So it helps the summer employees, as you said, who are probably mainly teenagers.
We definitely are the largest employee of children, if you will, or kids under the age of 18 and so on, definitely. Yeah.
And that's good because that teaches, one, a paycheck is always good.
Sure.
Interaction with the other people in the community is certainly good. And I'm sure many parents are glad the kids are working for the summer and saving money for college.
Absolutely.
So that all helps. So that's good. It's a good program where it allows many people to participate even at the wage earner level, maybe.
You know, and if you're participating in our programs, that money is going right back into the community.
Yeah, that's a good point.
It's going right
because the income tax goes right back to the city.
Absolutely.
So you can't miss on that one. Safety Town is something that I believe you took over a few years ago. Mm-hmm. Are we going to do a Safety Town? I think in the community park you actually set up a Safety Town.
Absolutely. If you remember, Terry, we actually we had a partnership with the Rotary Club and so on, mm-hmm. Kiwanis Club and so on, and the Solon Recreation Department. And we actually built the Safety Town. It's still a work in progress. We actually added some new fencing this past year. Mm-hmm. But actually was a nice project, worthwhile project. We're actually going to continue that this year. We're actually going to create, out of the old log cabin over at the Solon Community Park, mm-hmm. we are going to create a Safety Town classroom. So we actually have just gone through taking bids on that project. We're going to be taking those numbers to City Hall within the next, or I should say City Council within the next 2 to 3 weeks, and hopefully have that ready for the program this year.
And once again, if you want to enroll in Safety Town, you call the Recreation Department.
Correct.
Okay,
correct.
And they'll help you set it up. You know, as I said earlier, one of the beautiful facilities we have here is the Recreation Center and mm-hmm. the Senior Center and these setups. If I wanted to rent space here for a wedding reception or some kind of event, doesn't mm-hmm. have to be a wedding reception, can I do that?
All you need to do is call the Recreation Department again and ask for Dave Palig. Dave is actually our banquet coordinator. It's amazing to me that each year both the banquet rooms, the community rooms that we have are used more and more by the members of the community. Mm-hmm. We've shown each year gradual increase from the time that we started. So it's a nice thing to have, and people, even after 11 years, you know, you find people say, wow, I didn't know that you had this. And mm-hmm. So it's a great facility that we have, and we want people to use it, and that's why it was built.
So it sounds like 11 years ago, or actually a little farther than that, some of the goals that were set up by the Recreation Department for this facility have definitely succeeded.
Absolutely. Met and even exceeded.
That sounds good. That's always good when it works out better than you originally planned, right? If you wanted to make a reservation to use these facilities, the banquet facilities, mm-hmm. Could you do it like a year or two in advance, like if you're planning a wedding or something like that?
Sure. We actually, we didn't think that weddings were going to take off as much as they did. And as you know, you need a lot of planning and preparation for a wedding. Mm-hmm. So we do. We actually will take a reservation for that up to 2 years in advance.
Okay, so if you're long-term planning, you can accommodate that.
And just as an aside, you know, if you are shut out of the Recreation Center or the Community Center's portion of the banquets, we also have banquets over at the Grantwood facility also.
All right, and that's
a little bit smaller, but still very, very nice and very usable.
And that's a nice segue. Let's talk about Grantwood a little
sure.
bit. You know, we are fortunate in this city that we have a beautiful golf course in the Grantwood facility. The Recreation Department took that over a few mm-hmm. years ago. Now, I'm not a golfer, so I can't talk golf here, but I understand that it is widely used, it's priced right, and most people that have used it said, yeah, they really enjoyed it. What's going on over at Grantwood? What are we preparing for the spring, summer, fall season for the golf people?
Sure. It's hard to believe it's actually my fifth year, going to be my fifth summer over at Grantwood, so I'm excited about it. It's been a nice change of pace for me, and I think that everybody in the Recreation Department loves going over there, helping out in any way that we can. And we've become kind of a family with the employees at Grantwood, too. So it's been exciting. Andy Wolf, who is our professional, who actually runs a pro shop and also all of our clinics and camps, has been busy over the winter making sure that we're ready. People can sign up for those camps and clinics that we're going to run throughout the summer. We actually start in the spring. Mm-hmm. If you want to get an early start on that golf swing, whether you're an adult or children, starting usually about the age of 5, we can handle that. And we look forward to it. Doesn't look good right now, but hopefully within about 2 or 3 weeks, we'll be ready to go. So.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how the winter affects the greens and the facility over at Grant Wood, because this has been one tough winter with snow, that's for sure, and certainly cold.
You know, it's funny, reminiscing, Terry, I don't remember a winter like this in probably the past 10 to 15 years, so it will be interesting to see what kind of wear and tear it takes on the golf course. I will tell you that, as you said before, that the blacktop areas, I think we're going to be seeing a lot of renovations.
The paving companies are going to make money this year on fixing roads and parking lots.
It's been
a
rough winter.
Well, I'm sure the staff at Grant Wood is more than capable of handling it, so that shouldn't be a problem. 2014's coming up. What do rates look like? Are they going up, staying the same for Grant Wood? I mean, costs always have to go up, unfortunately. How do you see 2014 playing out?
You know, Terry, it's interesting that you asked that question. I actually, we did raise rates very, very slightly, about a dollar a round, whether it's 9 or 18 holes. But actually, the city of Hudson actually just did a study of the rates of the different golf courses in the area, all the public courses, obviously. And at the end of the memo that he sent to me, he said, raise your rates. You know, we're very, very competitive, you know, as far as the different golf courses around here. So we're quite proud of that. We want to make it affordable. We want the Solon people to come out and play our course versus other courses. And we're going to stay competitive and make sure that that happens.
Now, if you're a group of people who want to start a league or you want to take classes or whatever, once again, do you contact the Recreation Department? Do you contact Grant Wood direct?
You would contact Grant Wood directly and ask for Andy Wolf in the Pro Shop, and he handles most of that information.
All right, and it's about that time of the year where we should start thinking about golf leagues and setting up times and use of the course. Are we still going to have use of the course during the day, you know, Monday through Friday? I'm sure weekends are very popular.
Correct.
But do you get a little bit of a preferred rate if it's 10 o'clock on a Tuesday morning?
Absolutely. It's as with any business, you kind of gear your rates toward the busy times. They're going to be a little bit higher, and the weekends are usually like that. But one of the interesting things is that this year we're going to try to do a family rate on the weekends. We've never tried this before, and we haven't come up with an exact number, but what we'd like to do is get the families out there playing, especially like after 12 o'clock. It seems to be that Saturday and Sunday afternoons kind of lightens up a little bit. You know, everybody wants to play on Saturday morning or Sunday morning. We want to make that a family day over at Grant Wood, and we're going to try to make sure that we position ourselves that we get the people over there. So we're going to have some different tees set up there for some of the kids, the younger kids. Make it interesting for the family so that, you know, your youngster's not taking 15 shots to get to the green. You know, make it challenging yet fair for each age group and each skill set.
See, now you bring up an interesting point. As I said, I don't know much about golf other than you hit the ball. The Pro Shop, you said it's run by Andy Wolf?
Correct.
Okay. If I was just starting out, would that be a good Pro Shop to go to and buy equipment or take lessons? And if I was a, you know, Tiger Woods wannabe, could I go to the same Pro Shop and get that level of service?
We actually can get just about anything that you would need at any skill set. If we don't have it on site, Andy could always special order it. And one of the things we try to do is price match anything that you can get even at a Dick's store or anywhere else. If you get it, if you get a Titleist wood somewhere, we'll match that price. You know, we want your business. And so if you can find a great price, we would match that price.
Right, so you feel you could be competitive with the other stores
absolutely,
in the area?
Absolutely.
Oh, that sounds very
one
good.
Of the interesting things is, and when we were talking about families, we have started a partnership with U.S. Kids Golf. Which is exactly what it sounds like.
Okay.
What they've done is actually match the club length, drivers, putters, your iron sets, everything's matched to the height of the child.
Okay.
And as the child grows, they would work their ways into another set. You know, when I was growing up, what we did is we just sawed off the wood at a
That's
certain height,
what
and
I
you
remember,
played, and
yeah.
you know, you put tape on it or whatever you need
right.
to do. Obviously, that wasn't the best way to do it. We just got by and did it. But there's better ways to do that, and U.S. Kids Golf is a great thing for families, a great place for kids. We actually have some tournaments that they're going to run for us this year, so it's a great partnership.
Yeah. And Grantwood, as always, they still have the snack bar, so if you're done if you finish a round of golf and you want a hot dog, they can accommodate you.
We're there for you.
Okay, that
Absolutely.
Sounds good. Now, I am doing this kind of out of memory. Didn't last year we have a thing called Midnight Golf or something like that?
It was actually called the Nine with Wine.
The Nine with Wine.
We used to do Midnight Golf. Wasn't quite as successful the last couple of years, so we've kind of discontinued it. May bring it back in the future. But the Nine with Wine was very successful. It was actually run on a Friday night. It's more of a couples event, and it's okay. Exactly what it sounds like. There's a little wine tasting station at, we run just a par three course. We change the course around and make it a par three course, but mm-hmm. couples go around the course, and on a few of the holes, they actually have a wine tasting.
Okay.
Great event, and it's a fun mixer, socializer for those people, and if you score well, that's a bonus.
I was going to say, now, is this a case after they've gone through the course that everybody scores 52 or under?
Could be.
Okay, I was going to say, that's kind of like how I would keep score after a couple
absolutely.
Of glasses of wine. Okay,
whatever you got.
That'll work. Okay, correct. I think probably a lot more fun in many cases.
Absolutely, absolutely.
If I wanted to take private lessons at Grantwood, do they have such a thing?
Yes, we do. Andy Wolf would be the person to talk to again. Andy is a very, very good teacher, does private lessons, but you would need to contact him directly
okay.
to do that. We have some other pros there also that do some things part-time, mm-hmm. And Andy will set you up either with him or with one of the other pros.
Okay. You know, earlier we mentioned the fact that we have banquet facilities here at the community center. You also alluded that we have banquet facilities over at Grantwood.
Mm-hmm.
Once again, if you wanted to rent those for a wedding or an event, how would you do that?
You would call Grantwood again, and that number is 440-248-4646.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, you could talk to Leslie Sobey. She's in charge of both the banquets and the concessions. Really runs the place over there. She actually does a fantastic okay. job and is very cordial and would set you up and do a nice job with you for the banquets. A little bit smaller banquet area. Probably a maximum of about 150 people in the banquet area over here or over there, where at the community center you probably could get about 220. So it's a little bit smaller area, but still very nice.
It can accommodate a lot of people. And
sure.
And once again, lots of parking, good space, and so forth
right.
for people to use.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the favorite things I do is when I'm driving down 91 at night in the summer and I look over at our community park and I see, 20,000 kids playing baseball mm-hmm. or so, somewhere around there. How about the community park? We're still using it. Obviously, baseball. I see people playing volleyball. The swing sets are there. Mm-hmm. There's restroom facilities. Are we keeping our park up? Are we keeping so people can use that?
Sure. You know, the community park was always meant to be a passive area as well as a physical area, if you will. We have one of the better playgrounds in the area.
Mm-hmm.
At a cost of about $250,000 a few years back. You wouldn't believe when I first. Started working for the recreation department, we built a playground and it cost about $10,000.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with the different padding and the different safety features they have, you can see that the cost is skyrocketed on that, but well worth it, and it's a beautiful piece of equipment that we have there. We also have the pavilion, which has been there for a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
People can still rent out the pavilion very cheaply to have a summer picnic, and you know, we have all the amenities there. You know, you have the bathrooms right there, right next to there. You've got the playground right next to the pavilion.
Mm-hmm.
The sand volleyball courts.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to play baseball, soccer, softball, whatever you'd like to do, that's all there. So, you know, be it a family picnic or game of baseball, football, whatever you want to do, I think you can do it at the park.
Yeah, as I said, it's a beautiful facility. Mm-hmm. It's always great to see people using it and certainly encouraging people to use it. And like you said, you can do just about anything in there. If you want to have a family picnic, play on the swing set, play basketball, play baseball.
Right.
It seems to be all there. Don, we need to kind of close this out, but in terms of recreation in the next few years, what do you see the challenges for Solon Recreation?
The challenge is that we are becoming an older community.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the...
Well, speak for yourself.
Well,
I'm not getting any older.
Some of us are getting older. Let's
okay,
put it that way.
Okay, that's fine.
You know, how do we mold the senior population? What do we do to make them feel that their needs are taken care of from both the passive recreation? You know, we have a great facility here, the Senior Center. We need to make sure that we're working as a family and making sure that we're helping the seniors, not just from the Senior Center side of things, but also from a recreational standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to continue to look for different ways. We have a pickleball program in the gym now that is pretty popular. You know, we've gone from 2 courts to 4 courts in the gymnasium, and we actually went from 1 hour to 2 hours. We'd like to do something for them outdoor, you know, that to continue it so that they're doing that year round. And they have a lot of different unique circumstances that they need, and we just need to try to meet those needs also.
Do you see the facility at the rate it's growing? Would we ever have to add on to it? And this is not like tomorrow morning we're going to spend millions to add on to it, but like in long-term planning.
I assume you're talking about the community center itself?
The community center itself.
Yeah, one of the things is, eventually the Arthur Road Pool is going to see its last days, and we're definitely going to try to keep that open as long as we can. You know, we think that it's still a valuable asset to the city. But, sometime in the future, we're going to have to start looking at another portion of an outdoor pool here at the community center. The other portion might be the gymnasium itself. Mm-hmm. We actually, 11 years ago, part of the project was to put the footprint in there for a new gymnasium. Mm-hmm. Some things would have to change as far as parking, but we do have the space that we could do that. Mm-hmm. Beyond that, it might be a little bit tough because we are landlocked a little bit, but those are the two major areas I can see in the future.
Okay, all right, sounds good. Different subject. Do we have any programs or facilities for special needs people in wheelchairs, people with some kind of mental handicap, anything along those lines?
I'm glad you asked that question, Terry, because just this past month, we, as a recreation department, the city of Solon, just won an award through the Ohio Parks and Recreation Association.
Wow, that's impressive.
Thank you. And what it had to do with is our summer program, which is a summer camp for children who have a specific need. We partner with the Solon school system, and the children who have a ESY, which is called an extended school year, it's about a 5-week program. They'll actually go to school in the morning and then are actually free to participate in our camp, which is right there. We run it at the same facility in the afternoon. And last year we had about 20 children in this program. So it's an award-winning program, but it's something that we feel that's very beneficial to our residents. It's just another program that we can offer.
Is there a specific age group that this is geared to?
Yeah,
like under 18 or?
Yes, actually under 18. And we actually have two different sets of ages. The first age is high school age, and the second age actually, which we just started 2 years ago, is for the younger children, anywhere from, I believe it's third grade and up. We're quite proud of that program, which is part of our larger Blue Ribbon program. Mm-hmm. As I said, we are one of the few communities in the state that actually has a dedicated professional on staff. Most of them, what they do is they kind of farm out the different programs to different areas. We have a dedicated professional on our staff that handles all the Blue Ribbon programs, and we're quite proud of that. And I think it's just another thing that we can offer our residents.
Yeah, that's very impressive.
Thank you.
That you cover it that well. Well, once again, as I said, you have an outstanding staff, and this shows it. And as I said earlier, it comes to Solon Recreation, there's just about something for everybody. And I will jokingly say from year one to year 95.
There you go.
And I think you have things well covered. Well, Don, I want to say thank you very much for spending a few minutes this afternoon with us to update us on the programs. Once again, it's always great to have these programs going here. The community center looks fabulous as always. Sounds like you have some very solid long-term planning going in place. And we encourage all the residents of Solon to get out and do a little walking around the neighborhood and register for the programs.
As soon as the sun comes out, get out there.
Sounds good.
Thank you, Terry.
Don,
thanks
thank
for
you.
Stopping by.
I'm Terry Dean, and this was another edition of Solon Speaks.